been talking through a lot of our mission the last couple weeks, but we're going to start over the next couple weeks talking about some of our values. Some of you are saying, what are our values, Pastor Dan? Well, they're on our website. We also have them, if you walk right outside, in our cafe. They're printed now on some panels so you can see some of our values. We actually had a task force last year go through and establish what is the culture, what is the feel when you walk into a Calvary Church program or a worship experience or a small group. How many of you know every single place has their own culture or feelings, right? How many know when you walk into Starbucks, there's a certain vibe, right, young people, when you go into Starbucks, right? There's a certain vibe when you walk into Chick-fil-A. How many of you know it is their pleasure to serve you at Chick-fil-A, right? And so, too, there should be a certain culture feeling when people walk into this place. And we've defined certain values that say, this is what the people of Calvary Church are. No matter where we plant, whether we're in Delran or whether we're in a home group in Cinnaminson or whether we're in Camden doing missions projects, this is our culture here at Calvary Church. And so today we're going to be talking about one of our first values. Our first value is the value of relationships. Here's how we define relationships here at Calvary Church. We value initiating and working at developing healthy relationships. I could share a lot of great ways, I believe, in this message today that we could make an impact for our world through Christ. But I want to share one key thing that I've witnessed over these last couple years in ministry that I believe is one of the most powerful ways, I believe, to reach people for Jesus. And to tell you what I'm going to tell you, I need to tell you a story behind it. So I'm going to say what this term is first, and you're going to be like, that's kind of confusing. I don't know, as Pastor Dan, maybe, you know, been drinking too much coffee this morning or what, doesn't make any sense. But I call it frog kissing. Come on, everyone say that phrase with me. Say frog kissing. And it comes from the story, many of you know the fairy tale story, the story of the princess and the frog. Have you heard that story before? Okay, well, I'll tell it to you today. There once was a handsome prince. He was debonair and godly. He was so handsome that a wicked witch fell in love with the prince. The wicked witch wanted to be in relationship with this prince. And so continually she made passes at the prince. And the prince, obviously, politely declined. The wicked witch didn't like what the prince had to say. And so she said one day, I will cast a spell on you. You're no longer going to be a handsome prince. You will be an ugly frog. And the spell will never be broken unless you get a beautiful princess to kiss you. And so the handsome prince began to shake all over. And suddenly, he was a handsome prince no longer, but an ugly frog. And in his saddest voice, he cried, I can't believe nobody can see past my warts or past my ugly slime to see that I really am a handsome prince on the inside. And so he cried and cried, and days went by, and months went by, and years went by as the story goes on. And he was so sad, once again, because nobody could see past the green slime. He wasn't an ugly frog. He was a handsome prince. And then one day, the miracle of all miracles happened. A beautiful princess came skipping through the pond area. And for whatever reason, she saw this frog and she felt strangely drawn to him. And the story continues and the story goes on and says, for whatever reason, the beautiful princess ends up kissing the ugly frog. And suddenly the spell is broken. The ugly frog returns back to his state of being a handsome prince. And he picks up his beautiful princess and they walk off into the sunset and live happily ever after. Don't you love just a good fairy tale at church at 10 a.m. in the morning? Some of you saying, Pastor Dan, what does that have anything to do with our values? What does that have anything to do with reaching people for Jesus? What does that have to do with building healthy relationships to ensure that no one is without Jesus? I'm glad you asked this morning. I believe this concept from this story, if you look underneath the hood of the story, has everything to do with reaching people for Jesus. If we want to reach people for Jesus, we want to live out our mission, loving God and serving people so that no one is without Jesus, reaching all people. You know that every person matters to God. John 3:16, Pastor Paul just said, for God so loved the world that he sent his one and only son so that whoever, Any person who believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. How do we ensure that no one is without Jesus in our communities? I believe this. Number one, in a world full of put downs, we gotta dare to be a frog kisser. We gotta dare to see past the warts in people. You gotta look past the bitterness. You gotta look past the pride. You gotta look past that person at your workplace who's the, I know all the answers, I know everything that's going on, but underneath there's insecurities and fear. Dare to see past what's on the outside. Look past those people's physical warts to realize inside of them, there's spiritual royalty buried deep within them. You know, scripture says this, that all of us are made in the image of God. You know, 2 Peter says that we were chosen, we're royal priests of the kingdom of God. You know that Jesus even calls us, you were the pearl of great price, that he was willing to sell everything for so that we could just have a chance to know him. And as followers of Jesus, I think if we're really, really serious about our core value of relationships, we gotta be willing then to look past the flaws of maybe some people in this room and the flaws of some people on our workplace and some of the things that are annoyances to us about our family members to initiate a relationship with them to help them grow to be more like Christ. You say, that's great, Pastor Dan, but what's the parallel to the story of the princess kissing the frog? What's that all about? I would call that the kiss of encouragement. See, if I could tell you one simple thing that you and I could do to make a difference for Christ, it would just be watching the words that we speak and continually speaking life into one another. You know that the Bible calls us to be salt and to be light. How many know that salt enhances something? It gives it flavor. And light gives you the ability to see. See, so that's why as followers of Jesus, if we're gonna choose to see past the warts, we gotta then believe the very best in people and call out the best that we see in them. And see, Jesus did this all the time in his earthly ministry. In fact, we're gonna look at a passage of scripture today where he does this with one of his main guys, one of his main disciples, Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 18, if you have your Bibles. Jesus frog kisses all the time. He looked at his number one disciple, a guy that he sought to continually build relationship with. And he looked past all of Simon's flaws, which Simon's name, for those of you who don't know, actually means little pebble. He looked past all of Simon's flaws and he said, Simon, I see past your warts. How many know Simon? He was too cool for school. Simon had a temper. Simon had anger issues. How many know if you cut somebody's ear off, you got anger issues, right? Simon had some anger issues. He denied Jesus. Simon's the guy. He denied Jesus three times. And Jesus encourages him. He says, Simon, your name is no longer going to be Little Pebble. Your name is going to be Peter, which means big boulder. How many of you love that when Jesus shows up on a scene, he changes everything, right? He takes him from being a little pebble to a big boulder. He saw past his warts to say, this is who you're going to be. I love this. He says, Peter, I know that you denied me three times. I know that you have all these issues and baggage, but man, I love you. I see potential in you. These last 3 years, I've been building a relationship and pouring into you and speaking life over to you. I see you, Peter, and listen to this. Peter, listen to this. I see you, Peter. Listen, I am going to build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail. That's what Jesus says in those next verses. And he says, Peter, you are going to be instrumental in helping take the gospel to the early church. You're going to be a key player. You're going to be a key role. He says, Peter, while you were denying me, I was looking past those warts to say, this guy is going to be an essential partner in the future building of the church of Jesus Christ. How many are thankful that God always uses broken people to fulfill his plan? Whatever you've done, it's not too much for God. Whatever sin you're caught up in right now, whatever addiction you've found yourself in, it's not too much for God. God looks to you and says, I can pull you out of that muck and mire and set your feet on the solid rock, and you can have a plan and a purpose greater than you could ever imagine in Jesus. But I really believe this. It was the words that Jesus spoke into Peter that forever changed his destiny. I believe this, as Proverbs says, the power to life and death is found in the tongue. It's in the words that we speak. It's in the words of encouragement that we speak to others. And listen, if you want to be really, really great at building relationships, you're going to be really, really good at encouraging and seeing potential in people even when they don't see it. In fact, that word encouragement is really fun in the Greek language. It means this, literally, to put courage into somebody. And encouragement is so different than flattery. See, flattery is usually done. You're saying something that you actually don't really mean. You're doing something with ulterior motives to get something back for yourself. But encouragement is done in a way that focuses on what somebody is doing right instead of what they're doing wrong. And can we just pause for a second and just camp on that for a moment? Listen, I know that this has been a trying season for many of us. I know that maybe some of us, even in our families, are having difficulty with relationships. Some of us in our workplace may be having difficulty in our work relationships. Some of us, maybe with even our kids, are having difficulty in relationships. If you're finding a hard time being able to find things that you can encourage your spouse or encourage your kids or encourage your coworkers in, can you just find 1%? Can you just find one thing and give it 100% of your attention? See, I've found this. People have a way of becoming who we encourage them to be. So you don't have to be a great preacher, preach from a stage to fulfill our mission and values. In fact, dare I even say this, the easy part of proclaiming our church vision and values is preaching it from a stage. The hard part is for you and I to actually live it one person at a time. When we leave this church service, to love God and to serve people in a real and authentic way and to encourage each person, one person at a time, to believe this, we're building a bridge so maybe one day Jesus could walk across that bridge. Lou Holtz said this. He said, you can't motivate a group or team. You can only deeply motivate one person at a time. One person at a time. How do we build relationships? It starts by taking the time to speak encouragement into one another. Number two is this, to build Christ-like relationships. For developing healthy relationships as a church, our core value, number two, I would say is this, we do that by simple acts of friendship. Make people want the Christ that you serve. Make people want the Christ you serve. You see a need and you step up, meet that need. You maybe say a couple sincere words of encouragement, calling up a neighbor in this season who's going through a hard time. You know something that I do after services, mostly pre-COVID, because now everyone's bolting after the service, right? Because we got to follow the guidelines. Thank you for following the guidelines, of course. But sometimes if I would just be talking to a person and they would be talking about a need in their life, instead of just saying, I'll pray for you, I'd just say, you know what? Can we just pray for that right now? I'd just lay a hand on them in the cafe and we'd pray for it. Why? You see a need and you meet the need. In fact, Jesus was continually marked by a ministry of seeing needs, having compassion, and from that overflow, then meeting that need. In fact, that word compassion, it's one of our core values. We're going to talk about it in a couple of weeks. That word compassion is a great word. In the Greek, its word is this, spaglizomehi. That's a fun word. You can say that five times fast. Why don't you try it? It's great. Spaglizomehi. And what that means is it's like a deep tummy ache. It goes all the way down your stomach, a really, really deep tummy ache. It hurts really, really bad. And what that means is it hurts so bad that you have to do something about it. And every time you look at the New Testament and that word spaglizomehi, compassion, is used in reference to Jesus, there was a miracle or action that took place. Why? Jesus wasn't known by just feeling bad for somebody. He was known by seeing a need and meeting the need. See, compassion isn't liking a post. It's loving a person. And I just wonder, just maybe, if sometimes we get so full of hearing the word of God that our level of compassion and being obedient to the word of God isn't synonymous with the amount that we've heard of it. See, we're far more educated than in the things of God than we are in our actual obedience, I've found. And so Jesus is marked by this compassion. He's marked by seeing a need, meeting a need. You see, people are preached out, but they aren't friended out. See, whether you have a lot of friends in this church or this community or in this season, or you don't have any at all, we have to be the kind of church. We got to be the kind of people that intentionally seek to build and care for one another through genuine Christ-like relationships. Why? Because our world is consistently changing. And never before have we been so connected via technology and devices and social media and emails. But I would say the need for real, genuine spiritual connection and relational connection is missing now more than ever before. I'll illustrate it this way. That term friend is consistently evolving, right? Thanks to the rise of social media and technology, right? If you had a, 10 friends or 15 friends growing up, that was kind of a big deal. Now we get on Facebook and we have 350 friends on Facebook, and you have 1,000 people following you on Instagram, and you have, 500 people connected with you on LinkedIn, and you get a couple hundred emails every day from different amounts of people, and we call those people friends, right? I have 400 friends on Facebook. I have 1,000 friends on Facebook. So they actually did a study on this. And what they found is actually really, really concerning. While we say we have a lot of friends, the average American does not have more than 3 close relationships in their life. 3 close friendships in their life. See, never before have we been so connected, but dare I say this, we are more socially and spiritually disconnected now than ever before. And so there's somebody in this room that's saying, well, Pastor Dan, you're telling me I gotta build relationships. I gotta reach out to my small group more. I gotta connect with this person in the church. Or I gotta call somebody up and pray for me. Nobody ever did that for me. Listen, you know what I found? You can either get bitter or you can get better, right? You can make excuses or you can make progresses, but you can't do both. And so as followers of Jesus, we decide, you know what? I'll take my pain of what somebody didn't do for me and I'll turn it into purpose. Purpose to reach out to that person. Purpose to connect with that new person. Purpose to reach out to that person on the job and pray for them and build relationship. Why? Because God loves me and I know that God loves me and has filled me with his love. Then I have to love that person. Love that person. Jesus defines what true love is in John chapter 13, verses 34. He says, a new command I give you. He says these words, love one another as I have loved you. You must love one another as I have loved you. They will know you are my disciples, he says, by the way that you love one another. They will know you're my disciples by the way that you love one another. Here's what Jesus didn't say there. He didn't say they'll know you're my disciples by how smart you are and how much theology you know. Listen, theology is really, really important. Don't get me wrong. We should be students of the word. We need to study the word. But that's not what he said in this text. He didn't say they'll know you're my disciples by how many arguments you win on social media proving that your point is right. He didn't say that. What he said is this, they'll know you're my disciples by the way that you love one another. Man, do we want to be a magnet for this world? Do we want to reach people for Jesus? It starts right here with us loving one another. You're going to be my disciples, and a lost and dying world is going to know who you are by the way that you love one another, by the way you build relationships and do life together. 1 Thessalonians 2:8 echoes these words as it says, we loved you so much. We loved you so much that we shared with you not only God's good news, but our own lives as well. We shared our lives. We did life together, as Acts 2 talks about. We loved you so much that we not only shared the good news, but we shared our lives together. I'll illustrate it with a story that I think connects these dots really, really well. This is a true story of a young Buddhist foreign exchange student. She came to America for a year. And obviously, of course, we know that the Buddhist faith would lean negatively towards Christianity and Jesus Christ. Her host family happened to be Christians, though. And they wanted to have a student in their house because they wanted to, connect with them and learn more about a different culture. But they also thought it could be a great opportunity to share Jesus with somebody from the opposite side of the world and practical ways of friendship. And she came to their home and they paired her up with her American foreign exchange sister who was about the same size. And so they shared clothes and shared a room together and laughed together. And they went to this little church, the family's little church, every single Sunday. And this foreign exchange student went with them every single Sunday just out of respect. But honestly, her heart didn't ever soften at all to Jesus. And so it was spring and she was about to go back home after a year of being with this family. She was about to go back to her Buddhist country, but they went to one last church service together. And the pastor is preaching. He's preaching his guts out. He's preaching his heart out. And at the end of the altar, you know, at the end of the message, they gave an altar call to receive Jesus. And this foreign exchange student walks down the aisle to receive Jesus. The family was absolutely blown away. The Buddhist college student had decided she wanted to follow Jesus. She had never given any indication over the last year that she was even interested in following Jesus. She had never given any indication that their acts of kindness and love and friendship had made any difference the whole time. After they had finished preaching, the preacher of this small church sees this woman there and prays with her. And after all these moments, he says, "I would love to talk to you for a second. I want to have an impact on other foreign exchange students for Christ. What was it in this message that I preached today that made you want to give your life to him?" And she said really, really important words. She said, "Respectfully, Pastor, it wasn't anything you had to say this morning at all in your message. All year long, my foreign exchange sister has been building a bridge from her heart to mine through friendship. And this morning, I let Jesus walk across that bridge." I just wonder how many lives could be impacted around this world. How many lives could be impacted in our communities? How many lives are waiting to hear about Jesus, but we won't get out of our comfortable chairs and initiate a relationship with them? Man, you matter enough to me. Your extended family matters enough to me, man. Your coworkers matter enough to me. Man, your spouse matters enough to me. When is the last time that we got so desperate that we wanted people to know Jesus that we not just prayed about him, but we sought to build relationship so that could build a bridge that one day Jesus could walk across that bridge? Today, if you really want to be a frog kisser, if you want to see past the warts in people and really build healthy relationships, if you want to live out these values, number three, here's what you got to do. And I am consistently working on this myself. Let me just say this. I'm a work in progress on this one especially. Number three, you got to learn. You got to learn to listen deeply. You got to learn to listen deeply. Listening leads people to Jesus. Listening leads people to Jesus. See, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And what we have to do in those moments is we have to step back from all of the arguments and all of the rights that we have and why we need to speak up on this issue and that issue, and we need to pause and we need to listen. As James 1:19, the Amplified Translation says this about listening. "Understand this, my beloved brothers and sisters, let everyone be quick to hear. Let them be a thoughtful listener, not just with their words, but their thoughts. Slow to speak, a speaker of carefully chosen words, and slow to anger, patient, reflective, and forgiving." Voltaire says it this way: "The road to the heart is always through the ears." See, this is so true. And I think a lot of us in this season, we're really craving community. We're always stuck at home, or maybe it's tough to really connect with people in this season, you know, in the middle of a global pandemic. And we really want to connect with people. We all know people, right, that are just magnets to people. They seem like they just have friends everywhere they go, and it's really easy for them to build relationships. And then you see some people that they're always talking about Jesus, and they're always ministering to people, and they have such a gift. See, I believe this, the secret to being interesting is just simply being interested with the one who's in front of you right there. For other people to want to talk to you, you've got to genuinely take interest in them first. And it starts with asking questions. Before you tell them about Jesus, have you built a bridge through a relationship by being interested in them? Why? Because people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. Number four, how do you build relationships? Number four is this: you got to have the guts. You got to have the guts to put words to your affection. You got to have the guts to put words to your affections. I want to especially challenge the men to that this morning. I think sometimes maybe the ladies have it a little bit easier with one another. They can just feel something and maybe express a little bit. Guys, for whatever reason, sometimes it's just a little bit harder to voice it. But listen, I just want to challenge this with our church. Listen, if even in this building, right, if you see somebody do something good, tell them that they did something good, right? We have enough negativity in this world. We have enough criticisms and complaints in our workplaces and in our families and other environments. Listen, this should be the most life-giving, accepting, encouraging church in this or any parallel universe. In fact, Gospel Publishing did a study a couple years ago. They were studying the largest churches in America. And they wanted to know what was making these churches just grow. And so they surveyed all different sorts of factors. They listed the top 10 things. And you know what was dead last? Here was dead last. Fast-paced, technology-driven, excellent service. That was last. You know what was number one? Ahead of preaching, ahead of worship, ahead of kids ministry, ahead of the bathrooms being clean. You know what was number one? Welcoming, loving, encouraging, genuine, friendship-like church. You want to reach people for Jesus? It starts by loving one another in here. Have the guts to put affection, words to your affection. Proverbs says it this way, Proverbs 16:24. Gracious speech is like honey, good taste to the soul and quick energy to the body. Ephesians 4:29 says it this way. You heard this one a couple times recently. Watch the way you talk. Let nothing foul or dirty come out of your mouth. Say what only helps. Each word is a gift. Tim Keller says it this way. In his book, The Meaning of Marriage, he's talking about marriages, but I really believe this quote that he says in this paragraph can really be applied to any relationship right now. He says, in any relationship, there'll be frightening spells in which your feelings of love, care, attention dry up. And when this happens, you must remember that the essence of marriage is that it is a commitment. It is a promise of future love. So what do? You do the acts of love despite your lack of feeling. You may not feel tender, sympathetic, and eager to please, but in your actions to be understanding, you must then be tender, forgiving, and helpful. And if you do that then, as time goes on, you'll not only get through the dry spells, but they will become less and less frequent and deep as you become more constant in your feelings. This is what can happen if you continually decide to love even when you don't feel like it. Even when you don't feel like it. That's living a bigger and better life. That's being a bigger person. That's being a disciple of Christ. Even when I don't feel like it, I say, God, if you love that person, give me your eyes and perspective. Break my heart for what breaks yours. Let me see that this person is deeply in need of your love and help me now to speak your words of love into this situation. And then lastly, number five is this. If you want to make a difference, if you want to live this value, this culture of relationship that we're talking about here at Calvary Church, I'm going to say this, and it's another phrase that will need some explanation behind it. So I'll tell one more story to illustrate it. But number five is this. You got to go out and you got to change some people's tags. You got to go out and you got to change some people's tags. It's frog kissing. It's encouraging. It's seeing past the warts to see what people can become in Christ. It's building relationships and initiating relationship. Even if you do not feel like it. You remember Jesus did this with Peter in that excerpt of scripture in Matthew 16:13-18. He says, Simon, your name means little pebble. But in this moment, I'm seeing past your doubt. I'm seeing past your pride. I'm seeing past your ego. And now I am calling you Peter, which means big boulder. I love this. I want to read this excerpt for you again for a different translation so you can hear it. Matthew chapter 16:13-18. It says these words. Jesus came back and he said, God bless you, Simon, son of Jonah. And now I'm going to tell you who you really are. I love that. I want to tell you who you really are. In other words, because of the relationship that we have, because we've been doing life together for the last 3 years, because I know you, because I've built a bridge of friendship from my heart to yours, I'm going to tell you who you are. I'm going to look past the warts. I'm going to look past your attitude. I'm going to look past your anger. I'm going to look past the fact that you denied me 3 times. I'm going to look past these warts, and I am going to believe in you. Listen, that doesn't mean that Jesus was saying his warts are okay. It wasn't license for him to keep on sinning. He was just saying, I see more than your sin. I see more than your junk. And because we have this relationship together, because we've connected, I have the ability now to speak life into you. I'm going to change your tags. I'm going to change your identity. I'm going to change your name. You're no longer a little pebble. You are a big boulder. You're going to be a foundation of the early church. So by the grace of God, I believe this. There's a lost and dying world out there that has been labeled by their addiction, by their past, by their shame, by their sin that has held them captive. And I believe this, Jesus, by the grace of God, wants to help us build relationships so that he can change their identity into called, chosen, redeemed children of the Most High God. It's by changing some people's tags. Let me tell you the story so you can hear the illustration of changing some people's tags. Many of you heard this term triage before. And it's when there would be an urgent situation, such as maybe an earthquake or a bombing, a plane wreck. And obviously, they'd have to rush medical personnel in quickly. But usually in these situations, they would never have enough. And so triage is when doctors would go through the wounded to figure out who needs help first. And this story particularly occurred in World War Chapter 2. There was a guy by the name of Lou. And they didn't have all the medical advantages that we do today. And there was this man named Lou, once again, who was in combat. And while he was in combat, his leg was blown totally off. They put a tourniquet on it to slow the bleeding, but he was just an absolute mess. They got all the casualties off the battlefield and back to this large medical tent, and they began to treat them. And so in triage, they had to get a way of knowing who actually got attention first. During this time, this particular season of World War II, they would use tags to help identify. The medical personnel would evaluate each patient based on how badly they would hurt, and they would tag them accordingly. Red tags meant they would be okay, they would receive medical attention the last, they would be air-vacced out last as well. White tags meant you have to get medical attention to these people ASAP. And if you do, they possibly can make it, but you have to get them flown out ASAP. You have to start treating them right now. Blue tags meant do not waste your limited time and resources on them. These soldiers are not going to make it. They were too far gone. And Lou was so badly injured, he received the blue tag at the end of his cot. The doctors are saying, don't spend any time with him. He is too far gone. He's too far gone. He's not going to make it. His cot happened to be near a nurse's station. And when the nurse saw the blue tag go on, her heart absolutely dropped. Lou had lost a lot of blood. He was in serious trouble. And even though the nurse thought that he probably was going to die, she felt connected to him. She felt compassion. She felt something towards him. She got out of her chair and she said, you know what? I got to leave the stuff that I have to do. I want to give my attention to this man. He should not have to die alone. She introduced himself and she looked past his warts, if you will, right? His leg being blown off. He was not in good shape. He did not look good on the outside. She started just talking to him. She started asking questions about his life and his family and the sports that he liked. And suddenly she realized that Lou remained conscious for 5 minutes and then 10 minutes and then 15 minutes. And Lou might be able to make it if we get some attention and care to him. He shut his eyes for one moment and she ran to the nurse's station and she grabbed a white tag and took off the blue tag, meaning that there was no hope, and gave the white tag, meaning get this guy help as soon as possible. The rest of the doctors were walking around and doing their rounds and they saw that Lou had a white tag on and said, oh, we must have missed a patient. We have got to get attention to him. Get this guy flown out ASAP. Let's get care for him. The nurse ends up calling the medical station 48 hours later to realize that Lou lived, was doing well, and was going to be fitted for a prosthetic leg. Why? Because she was willing to change his tags. She's willing to change his tags. And that's what we're talking about when we're talking about relationships today. We're talking about building a bridge from my heart to yours. Listen, we're a church. We're in the tag-changing business. Listen, Baptism Sunday today, what we talked about today, literally lives going from death to life and purpose and hope, new life, new creations in Christ. And I believe that there's more than just the 8 that are going to be baptized today. I believe Jesus wants to do this through you in your workplace and in your home and with your families and with your children's. As you look past people's flaws and you look past people's junk and you look past maybe the rough things that they say and you see really deep down, God has a plan and a purpose for them. But he's waiting for you to build a bridge from your heart to theirs so that one day, just maybe through acts of love, next of service, Jesus can walk across that bridge.
We hope that you enjoyed today's service. Let's take a moment to talk about your next steps. If you made the decision to follow Jesus today, Hey, we love to celebrate with you and help you on your journey. Simply text the word follower to 97000. You'll receive helpful resources on following Jesus. Once again, thank you for watching, but we'd love to see you in person next week.